So today we are going to discuss in detail about the test which is widely used for determining the strength of the soil if you have to use it in the subgrid. Yes, and that test is California bearing ratio, or also known as CBR test. Okay. So this we are studying in lines with the topic that we started in the last lecture, that we were discussing about the soil subgrid, what are its properties. Yeah, we were discussing about soil subgrid and what are its properties, desirable properties. So in that we had this point, that permanency of strength, and I had told you that time that the strength is nothing but the CBR value that we are going to determine for our soil that we are going to use as a subgrid. So that CBR test we are going to study here. Now just to quickly introduce what is this test. So it was developed by the California State Highway Department in US, and this is one of the method for evaluating the strength of subgrid soil. And not only soil, but you can use this test to determine the strength of other pavement materials also, or whatever layers we had seen in the last lecture, the subgrid, and then you have other layers on top of it as the subbase and the base layer. So these layers also, the strength can be determined using this CBR test. Okay. And this CBR value is directly related to the pavement thickness. So this we'll see in the next unit, number 5, where we study the pavement design in detail. So there we'll come to know that how the CBR is actually related to this pavement thickness. Okay. So whatever is these thicknesses of different layers, so the CBR value affects all these layers. Okay. And it is the measure of resistance to penetration of a soil or a flexure pavement to a standard plunger. So you'll come to know what this statement means when we see the procedure for it. Okay. And what you have in this is, you have a cylindrical plunger of 50 mm diameter, and then you penetrate the plunger into the soil sample. Yeah. There is a whole setup, a machine is there having a load cell, or if it's a analog machine, you have a proving ring which measures the load that we are applying, and you have a dial gauge which measures the penetration of this plunger. Okay. And then it is penetrated at this rate of 1.25 mm per minute, and then we plot a graph of load versus penetration, and then we find out the value of load corresponding to these two penetration values, 2.5 mm and 5 mm, and whichever is the lowest, generally it is given that the 2.5 mm value, it should be less value or less load. But sometimes it also happens that the 5 mm or the load value corresponding to 5 mm, it is greater than the 2.5 mm one. And in that case, you have to repeat the experiment. And then too, if the results don't change, you have to take the higher value in that case. Okay. So we'll talk about this also when we go towards the analysis part of the readings. Okay. And it is determined in percentage, CBR value. So we say it is 10% or 8%. You have seen in the previous lecture that during the discussion of different layers of rigid pavement, there was a term that subgrade soil, it is made up of soil and murum, and then it should have a minimum 8% CBR. Okay. So that 8% is the way in which the CBR value is expressed. Now what actually this test is? So this is all the apparatus of the CBR test. Firstly, you have a perforated base plate. Now I'll explain the apparatus in the sequence in which the mold is prepared or the sample is prepared. Okay. So first you have a perforated base plate. You see you have a perforated base plate, and you have a two stand kind of thing attached to that plate also, and it is perforated as in there are small holes in it. Okay. And these holes are throughout the base plate, on all the surface of the base plate. Now over this perforated base plate, you place a spacer disc. Okay. Now this spacer disc is having these specifications that it's 148 mm in diameter and its height is 47.7 mm, somewhere around that. It has a lifting handle. Now we'll come to know why this lifting handle is also needed and I explain you the procedure of preparing the sample. Okay. Then you have a test mold. Now this test mold has internal diameter of 150 mm and its height is 175. So this much is the height of the test mold, which is 175. And the top one, what you see, that is nothing but the collar. Okay. So this is the collar. And it also has the internal diameter, the same as the mold, 150 mm, and its height is less, 60 mm. Okay. Then on the left side, if you see, you have a filter paper. You have a hammer. Now I have shown the side view and the or the interior part of the hammer, which is there in this photo, and the one which is covered also. So this is just a covering for that hammer. So it is a hammer of either 2.6 kg or 4.89 kg for dynamic compaction. This term is also important, dynamic compaction. Just remember it because you'll need it further. And if you see the weights, you'll find it, these are the same weights, or I guess it's almost equivalent to the weights that are used in modified Proctor and standard Proctor test. Okay. If I'm correct. Okay. It might be not exactly same, but somewhere around that Proctor hammer, you have these hammers as well. Then you have this straight edge for scraping off the excess soil here to level it off. Then you have a perforate on the left hand side. Again, if you see, you have a perforated plate with adjustable stem. Okay. Perforated plate as in, again, you have a circular plate which is having through holes in it. Okay. The perforation is throughout the thickness, and it has an adjustable stem. That this stem, you have a screw attached to it, and you can just rotate the screw or turn the, not screw, it's a nut kind of thing, and you can rotate it and you can adjust the height of this stem. Okay. Again, we'll see in detail why we need this adjustable height. Then you have annular weights on the right side. If you see, you have annular surcharge weight and slotted surcharge weight. So these are nothing but solid metal plates, you can say, of particular thickness, so that each one weighs 2.5 kg. Okay. And then you have a metal on the left hand side, the metal tripod and a dial gauge. This is for measuring the swelling of the specimen. And now all this I told you, or I showed you this apparatus, this we do it for the disturbed soil sample, as in you bring the soil from the site and then you compact the specimen or prepare the specimen in the lab. So for that you need all this. And if you have to take the undisturbed soil sample from the site, so obviously you have studied the core cutter method in your geotechnical engineering. So same way, you have this cutting edge over here, what you see in this figure or photograph. So this cutting edge is attached to the bottom of your mold, and then your mold is hammered the same way what you do in the core cutter method, that you have a core cutter which is the bottom side of that core cutter, it is having a sharp edge, and then you just using a rammer, you push that mold inside, and then you excavate the soil around the mold, and then you remove the core cutter as it is. So the same way, you attach this cutting edge to the bottom of your mold, and then you ram the mold into the soil layer, and then you take out the undisturbed sample. So you can do this test either on the undisturbed sample or on the disturbed sample on as well. So more preferred is the disturbed one, because that's the easy part. The undisturbed, it has a lot of ifs and buts, and you can't test a lot of soil samples using the undisturbed soil sample. Okay. So yeah, we'll come to preparing of test sample. Now what I want you to do is you can just note down, or if you have a phone with you, but if you are looking at the or attending this lecture on phone itself, so it will be difficult. So if you have a notebook and pen, you can just note down all these components of the apparatus, so that when I explain you the next on the when I go to the next slide, I can explain you, and I'll just speak the names of the components, and you can just recall the that if I say a perforated base plate, so actually how does it look like? So you'll come to know. Okay. So I'll give you a minute for this. Just write down the names, all the names of the components or the apparatus. Okay, I hope you have noted down. So now I'm going to explain you the preparation of the test sample, and I'll not show you the photographs. I'll just use the pointer to draw figures. So just bear with me if the figures are too shabby. Okay. So as I told you, what we do in this CBI test is, suppose we are doing it on a soil sample for a subgrid. Let's start from there. So we'll take the soil sample, and the prerequisite for this CBR test is that you have to do the Proctor test on it, on the soil sample, and you have to find out the MDD and OMC of the soil sample. Okay. Now, why you would need this MDD and OMC, I'll come to this in a short time. So for now, just remember, this is the prerequisite that first, before doing the CBR test, you need to find out the MDD OMC of the soil. Okay. Now, coming to the preparation of test sample, you have your perforated base plate. I am showing you the side view of it. Okay. So this is your perforated base plate with the guide rods. These are the guide rods at the, this is what you see, these are the guide rods. Now over this perforated base plate, you keep the spacer disc. Okay, now the spacer disc, if you have noted down, the diameter of that spacer disc is 148 mm, and the diameter of your mold, it is 150 mm. So there is a small gap. So your mold, it can be lifted through that spacer disc, because after that spacer disc is there only for some temporary purpose, and later on we are going to remove this. Okay. So this SD is nothing but spacer disc. So that's why that dimension are set in such a way, 148 mm and 150 mm. Now over this, you place your mold. So the mold is placed, and then in this figure, if you see, the mold is attached to this guide rods, and the capstan nuts are used to hold the mold in position to the guide rods. Okay. So in this way, you have to attach it, and then over the mold, you have to place the collar. Okay, so it will look something like this. So this C is nothing but collar, this M is the mold, and this SD is nothing but the spacer disc. Okay, and from outside, what you'll see is this view. Okay, or concentrate on this figure. So when you place all the things that I've just mentioned, the perforated base plate, the spacer disc, the mold, and the collar, then it will look something like this, because the spacer disc is inside this mold itself. Okay, it is there, but you can't see it from outside. Okay, so it is somewhere inside. So now once this is done, now our mold is ready, and now we can go on with filling the sample. So now filling the sample, what we have to do is we have to fill this mold. Okay, our main aim is to fill the mold with the soil sample. Now fill as in, now we again, if you go back to the test, what we are saying is that whatever subgrade we are going to use in the soil, we are testing this subgrade through the CBR test, and we are going to find out the strength. And if I go back a few slides to show, tell you this point, okay? So the more specification. Now what they have mentioned is, if you are laying a subgrade using the soil, so your subgrade, it should be compacted to at least 97% of MDD. Now this 97% is the limit that they have relaxed. Okay, so 3% relaxation that they have given, but actually it should be compacted to 100% of MDD. So now if we are saying that we are going to compact on site, our subgrade is being compacted up to MDD, and we are saying that we have to test this subgrade for its strength, and CBR is the test for it. So obviously you have to compare that soil in the lab also up to the MDD value. Okay, and that's why I told you that the undisturbed soil sample is not much preferred in CBR test as far as the subgrade is concerned, because we never keep the subgrade in its parent form or original form. Okay, we always compact it up to the maximum dry density, or at least up to 97% of MDD. And that's why we have to compact the sample in the lab also. So now you come, now you might understand, or you will understand the importance of this MDD and OMC. I told you that we need this. So why we are going to need it is because we are going to compact the soil sample in this CBR mold up to its MDD value. Okay. Now how to do it? Till now what you have studied in MDD OMC, that you had some standard mold, you had, suppose I guess 1000 liter was, oh, sorry, 1 meter cube was the capacity of that mold, 1 meter or something like that. Okay, I don't exactly remember, but it had some volume. And then you have to, you fill the soil in it in 3 layers or 5 layers, depending on the standard proctor or modified proctor. You compacted it, and then this was the first set. Then you took the readings, the weight values to calculate the density. You took some sample for water moisture content. Then you took out the same soil, you added some water into it, maybe 5% or 10%, you mixed it. Again, you repeated the same thing of compaction and taking the reading, and this you did. And then you, on the next day, after taking the dry soil readings, okay, the ones taken out from the oven, you were in the position to calculate, and then you found out the MDD and OMC, that suppose it was 2 gram per cc. So your MDD was 2 gram per cc, and your OMC was suppose 15%. So this you did in geotechnical engineering. But now what we are going to do is, you are going to use the same values. Say for example, 2 gram per cc is the MDD and 15% is the OMC. Now I am telling you that what we have to do is, we have to compact this mold or fill this mold in such a way that I get the density of the soil inside it up to 2 gram per cc, and the OMC is 15%. Okay. So now here you see we are doing the reverse engineering, that we have the dry density, maximum dry density, and now we have to calculate how much soil we are going to require, or how much soil is needed to fill this mold. Okay. But because just we can't, or if you are thinking like we'll take the soil sample and we'll pour 15% of water into it, 15% as in suppose I have taken 1,000 grams or 1 kg of soil. So in 1 kg, 15% of 1 kg, whatever is the amount of water I get, I'll just pour into the soil, mix it and compact it. So that will not do the or not serve the purpose because you are not taking into consideration the volume of the mold. So what you need to consider is the volume of the mold, the MDD and the OMC value. And then using the appropriate formulas and calculation, you will get or achieve the weight of the soil which is needed for achieving that density of say 2 gram per cc what we have taken in this example. Okay. So that we are going to need. So for this you have a formula. Now I'll not go into detail for that formula. It's just the basic application of your index properties of soil that you have studied. So using those, you know the density, you know the water content, you know the OMC, you know the volume of the mold. So using that, you find out the weight of the soil, okay, required to fill this mold. So generally, around 5 kg or so we need approximately. It varies from the soil to soil and OMC values. Now, once we are in a position that we know the soil that we are going to require for this compaction process, and we also know from the OMC value, again you have that calculation also, that what will be the water required to achieve the OMC, because you have to add some water into the soil sample. So these two things you should have in your hand before you actually start the mixing of your soil sample. Then you take the weight of the soil which you have calculated, you take the water required from the calculation, and then you mix it, and then again you come back to your mold. Now I'll not name it SD, M, and C. You know what it is. The bottom one is the spacer disc. The upper weight is the mold, and then the collar. Okay. So now what you do is you fill this mold in layers of obviously as you did for Proctor test. So you have to fill this mold in layers. Each layer you place suppose one layer, then you compact it with the hammer. Now whatever is this compaction, I'm saying that I'll just change the hatching. Now this double hatched or cross hatched portion is the compacted soil. Now when I talk about compaction, I can adopt two techniques for compaction. Either I can go for a dynamic compaction or I can go for a static compaction. Now, what is this dynamic compaction and static compaction? So, whatever hammer you see over here, so I have written that this is for dynamic compaction. That's why I told you to remember it, because we use hammer only if we are going to use this dynamic compaction. And if we are going to use static compaction, then no need of hammer. So, in static compaction, what you have is you know the weight of soil, you know the water, you mix it, you transfer the soil into this mold. And then you keep this whole assembly under compression testing machine. And then you apply the load in such a way that the soil compacted up to this density of 2 gram per cc. Now you will ask how to do it. So whatever spacer disc you have, that will play an important role in this. In static compaction, the spacer disc is not placed on the bottom, but it is placed in a inverted fashion, like in the static compaction. If I just quickly draw this. In static compaction, you have your mold along with its collar. Okay. You fill this with the soil. Okay. You don't compact it, and then you place your spacer disc over it. Okay. You fill the collar and mold with soil. You just dump in the soil into the collar or in the mold and the collar. So yeah, in the weight of the soil calculation, you have to also consider the collar volume. So once you do that, you place the spacer disc over it, and then you place it under CTM, okay, to give the load. And you go on giving the load until you'll see that the spacer disc has completely gone inside the collar and mold assembly. Okay. So the what I'm meaning is, whatever spacer disc we have placed here at the bottom, that was for dynamic compaction. For static compaction, you place it up and you go on giving the load through the compression testing machine until the top surface of the spacer disc, it flushes with the edges of your collar. Okay. And that is the indication that the soil has been compacted. Then you can remove it and you can trim it. So that's a different thing. I'm not going to discuss, or that is only the thing about the static compaction. But what is the main test or majority of the test, CBR test, they are done using dynamic compaction. Now what is done in dynamic compaction is, you had that hammer. Okay? So that hammer, you decide the blows beforehand that I'll give. Suppose now my experience, what we used to do in the company. So we selected these blows, 55, 25 and 10. Blows, these were the number of blows. So you fill the mold in dynamic compaction. Coming back to the dynamic compaction, you have this spacer disc at bottom. Okay. Now you fill the mold in 5 layers. Each layer you give 55 blows. Okay. That will be, suppose, mold number 1. So mold number 1, you have filled it with the soil, each layer having 55 blows. You keep that aside. Then you take the next mold, you take the same soil sample. So whatever is the weight of soil you have calculated using this formula, you will just multiply it by 3, because you are going to prepare 3 molds. Each mold will have or will be compacted using different number of blows. So the second mold, it will be compacted, or the soil will be compacted using 25 or giving 25 blows to each layer, and like this 5 layers. The third mold, it will be made by giving 10 blows to each of the 5 layers. Okay? And that will give you the 3 molds for your soil sample, same soil sample, 1, 2, 3. Okay? Those are the mold numbers, suppose. Now comes the part of removing some of the extra assembly. So now what you have done is, you had this spacer disc, you had the collar, and you had the mold. Now whatever soil you have filled in it or compacted, that will come up to the top surface of the collar. Okay. Or even maybe in some cases, it might have some edges protruding from the collar also, because you have taken the weight of the soil, or while taking this weight of the soil, you have considered the volume of the collar also. Okay. So once that is done, then what you do is, you remove this mold from this perforated base plate. Okay. Yeah, in between I forgot one step. After placing that spacer disc, you place a filter paper over here. I forgot that step, sorry. So here you place the filter paper, and then the mold, and then the collar, and then you fill in the soil and compact it. Rest of the things remain the same. So now what you do is, you first remove the collar. Okay. You remove the collar. Or we'll go step by step. I'll again repeat it. Just a minute. Let me draw the diagrams and then we can discuss further. Yeah. So now we have done the compaction. Now we have to remove some of the extra things that we have added into this mold while compacting. So first of all, look at the bottom portion of your slide. I have drawn four boxes, some shabby boxes I have drawn, or four rectangles or squares, whatever you can say. So the first one on the left, this one. So it is the perforated base plate having the guide rods. You have the spacer disc, you have the mold, and you also have the collar. Okay, and now the only difference is this is now filled with some soil. Okay, so first thing is you have to remove it from the, or you have to remove the perforated base plate. Okay, and you have to remove the collar. And after removing the collar, now you have the straight edge. In the apparatus, you had something called straight edge. So with that straight edge, what you'll do is you'll level the soil so that now only you have a mold and you have a spacer disc. Now here you don't have collar. So whatever was this collar, we have removed it. Okay. By cross, I mean, we have removed it. And then whatever is the material, obviously because we have removed the collar, there will be still soil which we had compacted because we had taken the volume of the collar also into consideration. So soil will be there and we have to just scrape it off with the straight edge. Okay. And now you will have a mold which is compacted with soil and you have spacer disc inside. Okay. Now what you do is you remove the spacer disc. Okay. Now here you suppose this is figure A, B, C and this is D. So in B figure, if you see, you have mold and spacer disc M and SD. And in figure number C, you have only mold, you don't have spacer disc. Now I have removed this spacer disc. Now you say when I remove the spacer disc, so the soil will fall down. It doesn't fall down because we have compacted to the maximum dry density. Okay, we have taken that much weight. Though what we have varied is the number of blows. So obviously the amount of soil that you scrape off after removing the collar, that will be very less if you are doing it for mold number one because that is compacted using 55 blows. When you switch on to mold number two, the amount of soil that you scrape off, it will be a bit more because that is compacted using less blows, that is 25. And when you do it for the third mold, the amount of the soil that you scrape off, it will be maximum because there we have given only 10 blows per layer. Okay. But anyways, that soil is compacted and we are not removing the spacer disc and keeping it inverted as it is. After removing the spacer disc, we are immediately inverting it, okay, flipping it. And now this is my mold, okay, the figure number D. So I have inverted it. Now what I have is you have the bottom. Okay, here you had the filter paper over here. Okay, you have had the filter paper between the spacer disc and the soil interface. So that filter paper will now come on the top side. Okay, and bottom side it is still the soil surface, you can say. Now this, whatever you see in this figure number D, you have to take the weight of this. Okay, so it will be weight of the mold plus the weight of the compacted soil. You have to note down that weight because later on you will need it in calculations. Okay. Now this is with the compaction. Now what we have to do is, now we have to keep it for swelling. Now why swelling? Okay, so now this is the mold which we have compacted with the soil. There is soil inside it. Now we have to keep it for swelling, or we have to immerse it in water for 4 days continuous, 24 hours for 4 days. Now why this swelling? Now again, come back to the Or recall that last lecture of ours in which I had told you that what are the different components of our pavement layer. So in that, the bottommost was subgrade, and we were saying that the subgrade, if I just go back to the desirable properties, so it should have this property that it should have minimum changes in volume and stability under adverse condition of weather and groundwater. And in adverse condition, what we mean is total flooding. That suppose your pavement, it is immersed in, or due to floods, the floods are so heavy that your whole pavement is underwater for suppose 7 days. So in that case, your water, even if your road is impermeable, the top surface is impermeable, your water will penetrate into the road through the shoulder and all the side areas, and it will try to saturate your subgrade, because subgrade, it is just soil, and by saturation, you know that once the soil gets saturated, then it cannot take any more water. So even if your road is immersed for 7 days, it is seen that a soil, it gets fully saturated in 4 days, a fully compacted soil up to MDD. So it takes 4 days. So that's why in this test, what we are doing is we are going to keep this assembly in water, okay, for 24 hours, 24 by 4, so 24 hours for 4 days, okay. Now how to or keep it in water? So again, your perforated base plate will come into picture again, okay. So this is your perforated base plate. Now we'll keep the mold in between this perforated base plate, but now the only difference is here you don't have the spacer disc. Okay, directly you have the mold, and this mold is containing the soil sample. Now I'll just hatch this portion which has the soil sample. Okay. And the top portion, whatever is the unhatched area of the mold, that is because there is, just a minute. So you have removed the collar, and whatever was the spacer disc, this spacer disc was over here. So that's why that much portion of the mold is empty now, because we have removed the spacer disc. So now what we'll do is we have kept the mold which has the compacted soil onto this perforated base plate. Over that we will keep, you already have the filter paper over here. And before transferring the mold to the perforated base plate, you also place the filter paper at the bottom. So top and bottom, you have filter paper over here, the red color line, what you see. Okay. Now over that, now I'll suppose use some another color. Over that, what you will keep is the perforated plate with adjustable stem. Okay. Again, okay. So just to make you clear, this perforated plate with adjustable stem that we are going to place over this compacted soil, and which has the filter paper on top. Okay. Now this plate is also perforated. Over this we'll keep the weights, annular weight and slotted weight. Okay. So from the side view you will see such layers, because these weights, they have slots in between. Now these slots, this circular slot or this, annular and this slot, it is because you have to remove it again after 4 days. Okay, so you will keep this. Now why this surcharge weight? Now again, go back to the site conditions. Now till now what we are doing is we are trying to replicate whatever are the site conditions into our test. So on site your subgrade was compacted to MDD, so here also we compacted it to MDD. On site it was susceptible to flooding and saturation, so here we are keeping it in water for 4 days. Now on site your subgrade layer is at the bottom, okay, and over that you have all other layers of pavement. Recall the last lecture I had shown you the cross section, okay, schematic cross section. So subgrade was at the bottom and then you had layers on the top. So now you have to replicate that also, okay, because just imagine this or visualize this. We have a soil which is compacted up to its MDD. Over that, you have the weight of all the other layers as well. Okay. So what are the chances that the water will percolate inside this subgrid, okay, or seep inside the subgrid? So the same thing we are going to replicate here. So these surcharge weights that we are adding of 2.5 kg each, those will replicate the overlying layers which are there on the site. Okay. And now how many layers or how many weights we are going to use, that will depend on what is your design over there, okay, on site. So suppose your site conditions are such that you have 3 layers or 4 layers over your subgrid. So accordingly, you will be knowing the volume of those layers and what material you are going to use. So basically, you will know the density. So you can convert it to the weight, and then you'll decide that, okay, I'll use only 2 surcharge weights or 3 surcharge weights, like that. Now, once this is done, now this assembly is kept into water. Now I'll take a bigger tank. Suppose this blue color tank is that water tank. Okay. I'll place your whole assembly, the perforated base plate, along with the mold. And that mold is having that compacted soil. Okay. There is a filter paper here at the bottom of the mold, filter paper at the bottom and filter paper at the top. And then you have the adjustable, the perforated plate with adjustable stem over here and the surcharge weight over it. Okay. Now this you have immersed in water. Now the moment you immerse it in water, okay, this is completely immersed in water. So water will start finding its way into the mold. So from where it will enter from the top, it will enter from the bottom, try to enter from the bottom because your base plate is perforated. Okay. It has through holes in it. It will, from the top, whatever the water is going inside, it will try to go inside the soil through the perforated plate again, which we have placed on the top. Okay. So we are replicating that same condition which might be there on site in the worst case scenario, that your pavement is flooded with water and then your subgrade is also getting flooded. So that same condition we are replicating. Now under this adverse condition also, what we need is the swelling property of your soil. So over this you will place that metal tripod with a dial gauge. Okay. I'll again show you the photograph. Okay. So this metal tripod and dial gauge, that is I have written for measuring swelling. So this tripod like thing, you will place it on the rest of the assembly. And now if you see the dial gauge, it is in center, and the tip of the dial gauge, it will touch this top surface of your stem. Okay. So this tip of the dial gauge, it will touch the top of the stem. And your tripod, it will be mounted on this side. Okay. So that is the arrangement. Now what this dial gauge will do is, for 4 days will continuously take the reading. Okay. What is the reading of the dial gauge? That will give you the swelling. Okay. So now you might think that we have compacted that soil up to MDD, and plus we are keeping so many weights, so there is no chance of water to percolate, and even if it percolates, the soil will not swell. This you might think, but it doesn't happen like that. The soil has so much strength, or the swelling pressure is so huge, that even in such compact conditions, it will push all the annular weights and it will lift, try to expand. Okay, so that expansion will be measured using this dial gauge that we have placed over it. Okay. So this is the setup. For 4 days, you will monitor it, the swelling, and after 4 days, then you will remove the mold along with all that perforated base plate and annular thing. You will keep it, take it out, and now you can use it for testing purpose. Okay. So till now, what I was telling you, or whatever I have explained, that is just the preparation of sample and conditioning it for the test. Now, once after these 4 days, after your 4 days, then you can test your sample for the CBR test. So that we will see in the next lecture. So just to wind up, this is the setup. Now this I have showed you a shabby kind of a drawing, but this is how it looks like. So this is what I'm talking about, the base plate, the mold actually, and they have just shown the cut section. So you have this soil, you have a filter paper, you have this surcharge weight, this is the stem over which you have this dial gauge, this tripod thing. Okay, so this whole assembly is kept in water for 4 days. And I have talked about this types of sample also. So static compaction, I told you what it is. We use the CTM. Dynamic compaction, we use the hammer and we give different kind of blows. And undisturbed soil sample, we use the cutting edge. So now after this, what we have is the testing part. So that we'll cover in the next lecture. We'll start with this slide, that CBR testing machine. Okay. So that's all for today. We'll stop here.